Thank you for that, and good afternoon. As he just said, my name is Stephen Balkam. I'm the founder and CEO of the Family Online Safety Institute. We are an international nonprofit whose mission is to make the online world safer for kids and their families. I just want to say some sort of points right up front. Our philosophical basis is that we believe in enlightened public policy that's based on the evidence, the research, and not on newspaper headlines or fear. We also encourage industry self-regulation in the forms of filters and tools and privacy policies. To that end, I sit on the safety advisory board at Facebook, and I do similar services for other of the major organizations. And also, we work to empower parents to confidently navigate the online world with their kids. And I'm going to talk a little bit more about that in a minute. We have nearly 30 members from Amazon to Yahoo in the alphabet, if you will, Facebook, Google, Microsoft, many of the folks who are here at this conference. We're headquartered in Washington, D.C., although we work across Europe. We have members in Australia, Canada, and so on. Okay, so I want to talk about the risks, the harms, and the rewards of our and our kids' online lives. But I want to begin by going back in time 20 years. Anyone remember this front cover from Time magazine? It's a little boy shocked looking at what he's seeing on the screen. And it was really pretty much Time magazine's first cover story about this thing called the World Wide Web. And of course, it was a big fear over what the RIM study at the time, which was later discredited, was showing, that basically a majority of the traffic and the majority of the content online was of a pornographic nature. It was considered so serious that the Senate Judiciary held hearings, the first ever hearings on pornography and the internet, in that same year. I was asked to testify. I was running a content labeling system at the time, which was all about labeling websites for nudity, sex, language, and violence. And our argument was that with labels and with filters, we could tackle this problem rather than with censorious legislation. The senators were not impressed. They passed the Communications Decency Act. But then later, the Supreme Court was not impressed with what Congress did, and that was then overturned. So now, let's fast forward 20 years, and this was Time magazine of a few months ago. And now the concern is not so much around porn. It's the little boy that we saw in the earlier picture is now grown up. He's married, he has a kid of his own, but he's so distracted by his phone that he doesn't pay the kid any attention. So we've gone from a fear and a panic over porn to a considerable concern about distraction, overuse, and so on. And also our lives mediated by these mobile devices that we all carry around with us, of course. Now in the cover article from that Time magazine, they reported a study that suggested that 46, nearly half of all millennials, had posted a photo of their youngest child either in the womb or before the baby was 1 year old, compared to just 10% of Gen Xers. And with all of this comes an extraordinary pressure to come up with the perfect photo, the most ideal presentation of yourself and your family. And it can be competitive and exhausting to get just the right caption to go with this wonderful photograph to maximize the likes and the retweets from your friends and your friends of friends. And yet, we continue to do so because we see that the benefits outweigh the downsides. Now, last year, my organization hosted a book talk with Sherry Turkle, the MIT professor, who I would say was very much a web and tech enthusiast back in the 90s, but she's become so concerned about what it's doing to us and to relationships that she's penned this book, Reclaiming Conversation. And she warns of a flight from conversation and how this impacts our inner lives and our relationships. she shows in her research is that there's been a precipitous drop in empathy among young people. Certainly over the last 20 years, but particularly she describes a 40% decline, most of it within the past decade. And as she argues, digital technology offers the illusion of companionship without the demands of friendship, and the illusion of friendship without the demands of intimacy. And she said that kids now have to fight their own phones for attention, certainly at the dinner table, or basically if wanting a cuddle on the couch, they have to try and get their parents to shut their laptops down. And she's very concerned about the rise of caring machines. This is Paro, the rather sweet baby seal that coos and cuddles, and which an increasing number of elderly homes are using because they don't have enough staff to pay much attention to the older people. And then there's Hello Barbie. Anyone heard about Hello Barbie? Okay, she had her policy debut at our conference in November in Washington, D.C. I was discussing with one of the senior folks from the American Academy of Pediatrics about the vexed issue of screen time, how much, how little, whether anyone under the age of two should be looking at a screen. And I handed him Barbie, who I had been playing with, it's my job, a week or two before, and Barbie actually spoke to him on stage. Now, what's remarkable about Barbie is that not only does she talk, but she listens. And she listens, and the AI that is connected via the cloud responds to what you say. So she remembers the names of my brothers and sisters. She knows that I want to be a doctor when I grow up. Unfortunately, she also keeps bringing up fashion, which I keep telling her I'm not interested in. But back to Sherry Turkle, her reaction to this was that she felt that this was toxic, that play should be something that it's imaginative, and it shouldn't be intermediated by a multinational like Mattel. Now, having said that, I've also been talking to some speech therapists and psychologists who see great opportunity and in terms of kids who are not able to speak in normal ways with their own kids. So when folks ask us, well, what is online safety? What does it mean to you? I put it down to three key aspects: acknowledging risks, mitigating harms, while reaping the rewards of our online lives. And we have a philosophical stance that you can't get rewards unless you take risks. Good risks, calculated risks, but risks all the same. And whitewater rafting is a great example. I took my teenage daughter and her boyfriend rafting in West Virginia a few months ago. We had to sign that we were willing to risk injury and even death to go on this trip. But because we knew that there would be safety procedures and protocol, we were happy to literally sign away our lives. And yeah, we got roughed around a lot and we nearly fell over, but it was worth taking the risks. Now, there are real harms. I don't want to beat around the bush on this. There's cyberbullying, there's sexting, there's overuse, there's kids showing up in classrooms with digital hangovers because they've been up at 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning. So we do have to address that. And one of the things that we've developed are the 7 steps to good digital parenting. And you can see this at the booth downstairs. We have handouts. This is also up on our website at fozy.org. And one of the things I want to particularly point out, in the very first one, and probably the best parental control there is keeping an open and honest communication with your kids throughout. You have to stay calm when you talk with them, particularly if they come to you when they've seen something quite disturbing. As one psychologist said, if you lose it, they won't get it. We also highly encourage parents to use parental controls. And there really is no excuse anymore. There are parental controls in every operating system, with every mobile device, search engine, and so on. And if you don't know, just Google it. And there's probably 7 or 8 videos, including the ones on our site, that will show you how to set up these filters. Now, while we try and encourage parents to talk with their kids, don't forget these 3 teachable moments. The first is when your child gets their first digital device. And that, by the way, is getting younger and younger. This is a tablet for a 2-year-old, for instance, the new Amazon Fire Kindle for Kids, the Amazon Fire for Kids, which was built with rubber bumpers, literally expecting it to be dropped by young kids. Also, the second one is when they get their first phone. And that, by the way, gets younger and younger. We're seeing now that we used to advise parents just as kids are going into high school was when they used to get their first phone. Now it's more like middle school. And now you even see kindergartners showing up with iPhones. It's quite extraordinary. And also when they turn 13. 13 is the age under COPPA, the Child Online Privacy Protection Act, that most social media sites like Facebook and Twitter and YouTube require you to be 13 to be on their platform. So use those three teachable moments. I'd add a fourth, by the way, for any of you with older teenagers, when they turn 16 and when they're eligible for their first driver's license. Don't text and drive. Well, it helps if you, the parent, also don't text and drive too. Okay, so we had some recent research which we launched just last year, asking parents about their concerns over their kids' privacy and their technology use, but also how technology was positively affecting their kids' lives. And a stunning 78% feel that tech has a positive effect on their kids' future, their career, and their life skills. And nearly twice as many parents feel that technology has a positive effect on the kids' ability to interact and to engage with other people than they do thinking it has a negative effect, which is kind of surprising given Sherry Turkle's concerns. So what will a Time magazine cover look like in, say, 10 years' time? Will the boy in the stroller now be strapped to a VR headset? And will Time be asking, are we losing our kids? Well, let me just come to a sort of end by quoting or reading out some quotes from some leading tech folks. So this is Mike Schropfer, this Facebook CTO. And he says that the company is effectively planning to build a teleporter by 2025. Facebook wants to build a device that allows you to be anywhere you want with anyone, regardless of geographic boundaries. Mark Zuckerberg in Vanity Fair last year, we're going to have technology where we can communicate our full sensory experience and emotions to someone through thought. And of course, Sergey Brin, who, by the way, says, famous quote from him, Google is not a search engine, it is an artificial intelligence company, now called Alphabet, of course. You should presume that someday we will be able to make machines that can reason, think, and do things better than we can. And of course, Facebook and Google are both working on connecting the next billion users. Google through their Loon project, and Facebook's drones, which will be able to remain aloft for about a month at a time, beaming down Wi-Fi to remote areas. So what's it going to look like when the Internet of Things becomes artificially intelligent? This is a piece I wrote in The Guardian last year. I suggest that perhaps we're going to have a conscious web, or web with consciousness. Will we live in a world that was depicted in the movie Her, where we literally fall in love with our machines and the operating systems that come with it? Or will we have machines that have developed so far that not only do they pass the Turing test, as what happened in the movie Ex Machina, but we even start to wonder if the machines themselves have consciousness? Well, whatever the risks and the harms that we'll be facing in the next 5, 10, 20 years, don't forget to explore, to share, and to celebrate with your kids. Go online with them. It can be a very humbling experience, by the way, to sit down with a 10-year-old boy and ask him to explain Minecraft to you. But you will probably need a 10-year-old to explain Minecraft. Learn from them and have fun. But at the same time, and go back to this key one, and probably the one that is the most important, be a good digital role model yourself. Curb your bad habits. Switch your phone off when you take the kids out to a meal. Make sure that the laptop is down when the kids are coming for you. And show them how to collaborate and to be creative online. So that's the end of my presentation. I very much hope you will visit us at our booth and come and see us. And if you'd like to partner or even join our organization, we'd love to hear from you. Thank you all very much.